So I'll just do a quick introduction. Actually, why don't we have you guys introduce yourselves? It'll be better that way, more effective. Hi.
Hi.
Congratulations, everyone. So let's go down the row and maybe do a quick introduction of everyone, beginning with Melina. Is it Melina? Melina Chaitu.
My interpreter down in the audience will be the voice you hear from me.
Right.
So your name. It's Malini.
Malini. Malini, sorry. Mm-hmm. Malini. I should know that. Malini Chaitu. So from Don't Shoot the Messenger, and then we'll go down from there.
Hi, I'm Caroline Marikostaki, and I'm the director of Us. I have in the audience today the actresses, Alice Carmelberg and Melody Cheng, as well as the sound mixer, Luigi Porto.
And excuse me, I apologize. I'd just like to add in, my team is also here. We have Craig Fogel and Jessica Wasserman, who are my executive producers. We also have Alexandria Wales and John McGinty. Alexandria is an actor as well as a director as part of the series. So I'd love if you could see them. Can they stand up so you can see who they are?
Great. Yeah, everybody introduce who you have with you, sure.
I'm Nadia Zoe. I'm the co-writer and director of Mariachi Madness. Here we have Ramon Torres, who is actually the lead actor, co-writer, and one of the producers of the film. We also have Mike Karp, who is one of the producers, and Justin Wilson, who is one of the police officers.
So I'm Danae Grandison. I wrote and directed Redefined, the coming-of-age short film. And here I have two of my actors, my lead, Jay, the young fella, and Uncle, right beside him, as well as my producer, Eva Minamar. I don't know where you are, Eva. Where are you? I see you. Hi. Okay.
Hi, I'm Jenna Lorenzo, and I'm the writer-director of Girl Night Stand. And here with me is Meryl Jones-Williams. She's the other actress in the film.
I'm Don Han, co-writer and director of Corkman. I have my producer, Eva Minamar, here, and Christopher Piccione, my actor. I can't really see. Hildy Scapel, and I think Francesca, my costume designer. I think that's it. If I'm missing anyone, it's just because I can't really see. Sorry.
So similarly, let's go down the row here. We'll just go film by film. Tell us why, first of all, tell us, how did you come up with this subject for your film? And why you came up with the subject of this film, and just take us through the initial thought process and development of where this all came from and why you decided to make this film for each of you. We'll start closest.
All right. Craig and I have just decided that we wanted to be a part of the YouTube workshops, and we learned more about web series that they're so popular, and we thought, why not create a story for YouTube? And we decided to look at a series that would entail an interpreter and deaf characters. And we wanted to talk to other people in the YouTube workshop, and they were very excited about it, so we thought, why not? We called deaf writers together to throw ideas. And of course, Jessica Wasserman, as our executive producer, became involved, because she has more experience in business and marketing and also contributed ideas. And we hired Alexandria Wales as our director, and another woman from Los Angeles, Jules Dameron, was another director, because we wanted to showcase their work as well, having a deaf crew and deaf professional actors. And of course, we've involved not only deaf people, but hearing people as well. And we wanted a series based on the life experiences of deaf people. And we have deaf community and hearing community members, and we thought there were a lot of opportunities for comedy in there. and we thought we'd just produce a series.
Before we move on, this is one episode. Can you tell us, is the rest of the series similar to this episode, or is it very different, and where does this episode fall within what I'm assuming is your first season?
Yes, thank you for that question. We showed episode 3. We had a pilot on YouTube, which we released and then did fundraising, and we were able to create episodes 2, 3, and 4 that are currently on YouTube. And you can watch the entire story as it plays out with each episode. We've filmed episodes 5, 6, and 7, and we're hopeful that they will be out soon. So please keep your eye on our channel and tell your family and friends. And it's a comedy series, so that's what you're seeing throughout the series.
And is it the same characters, basically, the same lead characters?
It is the same lead character. Yes, and that's Jacob, who is the lead character, and then there are main deaf characters in it, but of course there are a variety of others who are involved in each episode. And episode 7 will be interesting because we've created a further series to come down the row from that.
Oh, great, wonderful. Okay, so moving on. Tell us again where your project came from and why this particular story is the one that you decided to make for this film.
So my girlfriend encouraged me to do a film about something I know. And then I always wanted to make a film something in our kitchen. Because it's a small kitchen, I decided to do it in one still shot, which actually worked really well because I really wanted this film to feel real. And so I combined the two things together. I started to write a story about two women, dealing their relationship together, and then everything happens in the kitchen. So.
Great.
So with Mariachi Madness, I've worked with Ramon several times, and actually a director in the Columbia MFA program, and so we worked several times together, and like just through like class exercises and a whole bunch of other things, and he approached me one day and was like, I have this idea for a script, and I would really love to do this, and you know, would you be interested in collaborating on that with me? And I was like, you know, he told me the story, and you know, I found it very intriguing, you know, just really the relationship, and especially since I love stories about family dynamics and, you know, specifically complicated relationships between them. And so we just sort of started really wanting to collaborate together and find the perfect project, and, you know, everything just sort of fell in line as it, you know, sometimes does. And that's kind of how it all came together.
Hi. I just want to add that I didn't mention one of my actor's names. His name is Jesse Means. I just called him Uncle, and I think I owe him the right to have his name mentioned. Thank you. Okay, so Redefined is my thesis short film. I attended SVA last year, and it was a one-year program that was very intense. I came into the program knowing what I wanted to do. So I had, in the summer, thought, I wanted to work with my son on at least one short film in my lifetime, and he was also the character in there. And being it that I wanted to work with him, I thought, what story could be close enough to what was, you know, in our realm? And I really wanted to work with a theme that dealt with acceptance and conflict for kids his age, eighth grade, have a close friend that could be going through their own situation, and he has his own situation, and being surrounded by adults that are there to show you that you have someone. So I gave Jay an uncle that's there to help him, just bring him back and realize that life is not that crazy. You know, you have me still to come and talk to. And then you had the mother that knew her child was a trans and was accepting, and also changed that narrative, where we could see that we're not always in households where kids can't confront their parents and they shouldn't feel alone. So my main goal was to show acceptance and show that these young kids at eighth grade are not alone as they're going through their search of identity. So that's where that comes from. Motherhood inspired, wanting to let my son and, you know, anyone his age feel like this is not a lone journey. So that's how I got there.
Girl Night Stand, I just made because I had a feature at the time that I was trying to make, and I had never directed anything, and trying to get a director to attach themselves officially to a project when there's no financing in place is challenging. So I was like, I'm just going to direct it. And so I had to do a short to show that I could direct, so that I could show financiers. And that's sort of what happened. And then I did just make the feature. And yeah.
Congratulations. That's great.
I went to the same program as Danae, like the year before. So that's how, that was the thesis film. And so when we're like trying to come up with ideas for the thesis, like it was a little tough because they gave us like 10, like, you know, you have to make 10 ideas or something. And me and my co-writer just, you know, come up with one of the ideas, like everybody find it kind of interesting. It's a guy with a hole in the head. And we have to write a story around it. It was originally inspired by Francis Bacon's painting, and then we have to come up with a story. So he said, like, you like noirs, like femme noir, so why don't you write something like that? So I wrote the first draft and then kept on going. So that was that.
Great, all right. Is this still on? Yeah. Okay. All right. Let's move forward from that point, from your idea generating, to how did you guys get your script up and going? Was it all writing, or was any of your films improv'd? Did you go immediately into casting? What bring us forward into how you go from idea into scripting, casting, getting the money together, and then day one of shooting, et cetera. We'll start here.
Craig, can you stand up so that you can be seen? All right, Craig and I were tossing around ideas, and we attended a script workshop, and it was Craig's first time attending the script workshop. So we had some ideas, and thought we would go ahead with the actual process of writing, not just a pilot, but several episodes. And as we read through it, it didn't seem quite right. So I needed to bring in more deaf writers who had experience, because we want Craig's experience as a hearing sign language interpreter to be complemented by the deaf experience. And we had a process where the writing evolved, went through many changes, and I felt greatly improved. And we not only had the deaf perspective, but we called in other people who gave us feedback from both deaf and hearing worlds. So when we finally got to a point that we liked it, we then had to select our crew. And Jessica Wasserman joined in with us. And in our discussions, we realized that we wanted to hire female directors, that was an agenda for us. And Alexandra Wales had a great deal of experience in theater, and we felt that she would be appropriate for our series. And she hadn't worked on camera, but we wanted to give her this opportunity. So once we had her, she was very excited to be a part of the crew. And the next, we had John McGinty, who is one of our deaf writers who was involved with us, and had already experienced theater himself as a professional actor. And then we cast. So we wanted to find cast that would fill all the diverse roles that we had. So we reached out to a DP who happened to not be deaf, he was hearing. And we had a hearing editor who had a deaf wife who knew sign language. And that way we could have the eye for the editing to make sure that there was continuity of the signs and the communication throughout the script. We began our shoot, and the pilot episode came from out of our pocket from the three executive producers. We just wanted to make it happen. And when it was completed, we were enabled to go through Indiegogo, and we fundraised for episodes 2 through 4, and we had enough money to be able to complete those and shoot more. So of course, we then were able to receive a grant from the Women in Film, New York Women in Film, for their support, which allowed us to then complete episodes 5, 6, and 7, which we had shot, but we're currently in post-production and we will be releasing them as soon as possible. But it's very exciting to see this, and I was wondering about what your reaction would be to our show.
Good. So far, so good. All right. Yeah.
So I usually write many drafts. I send it to friends. They give me notes. And then I ask her if she could come to the audition with me for her, for the person who was going to be in front of her. And then I ask her, do you know any Asian American actress that you want to work with? And she said, yes, I worked with Melody. I would love to work with her again. But I said, you know, I have to do auditions just, you know, in case I need a backup. And so we did an audition. Alice was there, and it was great to see also the scene, how it worked. And Melody was just the best of the audition. So I was very happy. And then so I wanted to be really real. We didn't do any rehearsal. So we shot the film that is 18 minutes in one day. So it was a challenge. I thought, you know, if we need it, we will shoot a second day. So we only could do maybe 3 takes of every scene that had no cut. So it was really, really hard for the actresses, but I think it really worked because they were really amazing. And what else was the...
So you guys, you shot the whole thing all the way through every time? Is that what you're saying? There were no...
Yes, every scene was had no cut, so we had to go, yeah.
And how did you, if you don't mind saying, how did you guys finance it, or did you just do it?
Oh, I just financed it myself, yeah.
Well, I mean, this was definitely a major collaboration. So it started with Ramon having this idea, and actually he had a script, and it was a very big idea script. So there's a lot of like locations and a lot of like logistical things that we couldn't necessarily do with a low budget. So I think, you know, the very first conversation that you really have, or what we really had, was, okay, what can we actually do with this very small amount of money? And we were like, well, how much money do we actually have? So I think we had like $3,000. And we're like, okay, how do we do this? How do we make this script, or this idea for the script, translate into a $3,000 idea? And so we really just sort of then had a lot of conversations about paring down the script, simplifying, you know, really focusing on this, what was important to us, which was the relationship between the father and the son. So we really concentrated on that, and through a lot of going back and forth. The other thing too is we also had a timeline too. When we first had our conversation, I think like March, and I was supposed to be shooting my thesis film in like June, and we were like, okay, well, we have to shoot this in May. So everything was kind of like an expedited process. So there's just a lot of conversations. And anytime when you're co-writing something with somebody, you know, and you're both like type A personalities, you know, there is a lot of like checking your egos at the door, and, you know, like definitely... I will have to say it's really great working with Ramon, because I think that coming out of a program where you're just a writer director all the time, it is kind of really reassuring and liberating to sort of work with somebody who is really great and generous and really open to ideas and they're really open to conversation. So anyway, so after we had many, many conversations, as you can tell, we finally, like, we had a casting director who went through, we had our lead actor, of course, because it was Ramon, and then we went through a casting director, and then just continued to rewrite through the process. I mean, even in our casting session, originally it was one police officer, and then as we went through the casting session, we realized that we had these two great actors we really wanted to use, so then it became two police officers. And I also really love improvisation. It's something that I really enjoy doing. I love doing it in rehearsals. So we had, like, once we were cast, we had 2 days of rehearsal, and I made sure that I did a lot of improvisation with the actors so that they can really embody the characters. And once again, another layer of rewriting. And then we had like 2 days of shooting to do all this stuff. So it was kind of just like a race, but it was really incredible. It was a wonderful experience. And you know, I think that's probably about it.
Okay, I think I remember the question, but I'm just going to go off of how everyone's been answering. So how I got to the script, I went into the program already knowing my story. So one day, over about 2 weeks, I started writing it down from beginning to end, but I've never written a script before. So then I had to go through class. And through our writing teacher, who was Alex Delanaris, and he started to showing us the fundamentals and how to get a script going. Went through that process and then submitted it to school. They approved it and they're like, okay, you guys are ready to shoot. By this time, I've already hired my producer, Miss Eva Minamar. And then we began our casting session. We were the casting directors. And essentially, when I was going to work with my son, I got that heat where I was like, no, make sure this kid can act. So it was good when we didn't get that many boys that showed interest in the role, but it was good when Eva even turned to me one point. She goes, he's the one. Let's stop looking. Let's find everyone else. So between her and myself, I think we did probably like about 4 sessions and did the callbacks and just, you know, went with it. Is another part of the question I'm not answering?
No, you're doing great.
Okay. Because this is where it ends. and then I went to shoot. And of course, it's a huge collaboration. And it can't be done without a cast, because without them, there's nothing to watch. And the collaboration of my DP and my producer to just bring all the rest of it together. So, yeah.
With Girl Night Stand, the title sort of just came to mind. And I was like, oh, I like that title, Girl Night Stand. What can I do with that? And then I just sort of wrote a script around that. And then I sent the script out to people and got some notes and did some rewriting. And then we got a casting director, Mia Cusimano, and we did 3 days of casting until we found Meryl, who came in first. We should have just hired her. It would have saved us some time. And then I begged the people who shot with me, my DP and my editor. We've worked together since 2011. So I begged them to basically do it for free, because I was like, I feel like we'll get a feature out of this. And they believed me. So we shot it for nothing, and we shot it in Jersey City, so we got a lot of favors. The ice cream place let us eat so much ice cream for free. And then we shot everything in 2 days, and that's it. Yeah.
So my script had originally had 3 lines of dialogue. I think it was, I'm sorry, you like that? And congratulations, and it all got cut like at the end. So it's an interesting question, because when we had to cast, we were like, oh God, what are we gonna do? Because we have no, because everyone knows that you usually like read the size for auditions and stuff. So we have to come up with something for the actors to do. So I have to actually write like size. It has nothing to do with the script. And then when we're watching the auditions, like we were like, you know, when we play back at the home or whatever, we just like muted and see who did the best. And it was like kind of a really interesting auditions for, everyone. And I learned a lot from that, because the no dialogue thing. So Chris and I can't really do much rehearsal because of no dialogue. So went out for drinks, get to know each other, you know, bond. And when we get on set, you know, we were like best friends. And, you know, I think I had one scene that he was sleeping by the window, like in his bed, like holding the plan thing. That was like, it was supposed to be more of the plant from in the script, but it just didn't have time to shoot that much inserts. So at that scene, and I was having a fight with my AD, and then there was no time, and I just gave Chris the plan to like do something with it, please. I had it in the script, but I have nothing now. Just do something. So I think like, yeah, I was really glad to have Chris as Corkman. Thank you, Chris.
So I'll briefly ask like one little question here and there. We don't have much time, but so with Quarkman, I'm curious, is obviously you guys did a lot of work on design and atmosphere, both on set and in post. And I saw you saw, did you shot this on in a studio or you shot this at, on locations? Or how did you guys put together your design plan and what how did you guys execute all this stuff?
We did a lot of visuals, so I just keep sending DP and art references, like how things look like. But, you know, we don't have that much options when you have not that much money. But we found this studio that is called Rolling Studio in Greenpoint, and they have, like, a vintage apartment inside there, and they let us film there for really cheap, so I was really thankful, and fit with the theme. And everything else is shot on location. I mean, no studios, just as it is.
So the apartment was preset for you guys, but you found the rest of the locations.
Yeah, the building has a vintage apartment just come like that. So I didn't have to do much. I put a dresser in there, I put a mirror and a bed frame. So dressed it a little bit, but the wall was like kind of with the, I don't know how to describe it. It just had that little motifs and stuff. It's interesting.
Cool. And Girl Night Stand, I'm very curious if the Walk of Shame was based on a real epic. Because it's a pretty epic Walk of Shame. I mean, my God.
This is being videotaped, right? This is a recording.
So that's a yes, or?
It's inspired.
It's inspired. Good answer. Good answer. All right. So Mariachi Madness. I'm curious. Directing comedy is very difficult. So I'm curious what your process was. Did you build a lot of it in post, or did it just kind of come together from the script and production and in production?
I think that definitely things are different with different directors, but for me, I think that comedy really, I'm all about the timing, and I think that it really needs to happen on set and not necessarily as much in the editing room. So, I think that we did do a lot in the script, but a lot of like where the really moments come out, it is a lot of improvisation, and it's a lot about building that comfort level and, just really letting them have that back and forth. Of course, like I think that you have to have a really strong editor to understand and see those moments, but I think overall, I mean, for me, it's really about creating them in the moment when they're happening.
I should ask the same question for Girl Night Stand. And especially since you directed yourself, I mean, that's pretty, it ain't easy to direct yourself, period, but in comedy, I'm curious what your process was.
It kind of reminds me of playing sports, you know, like you sort of just like, if you throw a ball, the person either catches it or doesn't. That's the only way I could explain it. Like with Meryl, there was stuff that was scripted that was either working or not. And if it didn't, there was a lot of improvisation. But there's just a rhythm that seems to, I don't know, it feels like sort of a dance. And if you're not feeling it, I don't know what to tell you.
All right. For Redefined, can you talk about working with young actors, and especially, did you have any issues around the trans subject of the film and working with actors in general, young actors in general?
I would say a lot of people come with the initial fear, oh my God, you're working with kids. I'm like, they're not that horrible. I live with one. I can communicate. I'm okay. So, I didn't have any problem in that regard. I would say for my trans, she was your most girliest girl you could ever meet. And I had to find ways to tomboy her up. And no one actually knew she's as girly. I mean, she's really girly. I mean, she's a girl that comes and she poses and stuff like that. So I felt accomplished. I was able to tap into that with her. And then with the other young male lead, I would say my only other concern was getting him to not see me as mommy on set and then realize that I was a director. And then he finally showed up on set. Leading up to that, I wasn't sure if he was going to. And then my last other younger female character, I would say she was actually older than the both of them. Myself and my producer didn't realize. She was like turning 17 while these two were like 14 and 13. She turned 13, so she's a little bit more mature. And for the only time I really had more of a challenge when I had the non-actors. And the non-actors were the kids that were for the fight. And I had a couple of them like, I need for you to do it. And this one kid's like, I'm getting scared. I'm like, I ain't got time for you. So I just moved him from another position. So, you know, it was overall, it was fine. And it was still fun. And I enjoyed the process with them.
Great.
Yes.
For us, so you mentioned the single camera, single spot, single camera. So that's, you're removing a lot of choices, obviously. It's a risky business doing that. And you're kind of using... You've slimmed down your sort of filmmaker language to a couple things, right? So what's going on in the frame and then a few fades here and there. But what I noticed was I liked how you used your set in the same frame to indicate the passage, not just of time, but of their relationship. Can you talk about that a little bit?
So the kitchen is really small, and I think the fact that there's no cut and the camera doesn't move really, and I hope it forces the audience to watch, like maybe they're in the theater. And I feel like sometimes when you have too many cuts or too many close-ups, you tell the audience too much what's happening, and I really wanted them to feel like they were maybe watching a documentary or a reality TV show, because it's just you watch wherever you want to watch. And in terms of art, yes, so passage of time and also their relationship, like the art on the wall would tell, you know, are they together still or not, because the art is falling apart. And then yes, so.
Great. Well, don't shoot the messenger. So obviously it's a lot about, the film is, the series is a lot about communication. And I was curious about your choice to break the fourth wall with that character, and if that feeds more and more into the entire series, or it's just something that's happening in this one, or what was the decision process for that?
Okay. Craig, would you actually like to answer the question as one of the writers? Because Craig was the creator of the series, so I wanted to allow him the opportunity to answer. Why don't you come up front here?
Yep.
Come right up. Come on. Craig Fogel. I know he's kind of shrinking his way up here.
Sit on her lap. Here, you got that.
English. Okay. So we already knew that we wanted to see more authentic representation of deaf people and people who use sign language in media. So we knew that this hearing guy would be the lens or the gateway for the majority of people to come into the world. And so to have him directly address those hearing people, especially in scenes where they've been watching just sign language for a little while, seemed like a nice way to ease them in. And it was actually, we went back and forth about how to do it. We thought about doing like a cutaway, like on The Office or something, where he would be sitting in his room and talking about it later on. And Alexandria really pushed for the kind of Saved by the Bell moments. So that way we could preserve the awkwardness or the, whatever the emotion was of the moment.
Cool. So we're going to have to wrap up, but I do want to give everyone a chance to very briefly is the main word here, tell us what you're doing next, and if there's any place that these films are going, or whatever you want to tell us that's up next for you guys. Let's start on the end. We'll start it.
So I've been doing quite well with this little film, and I think we won Best Thriller at Aesthetica as one of the festival in the UK. And we have another short in the festival right now, writing Corkman feature.
Girl Night Stand is playing at a few other festivals, and I'm currently in post on my feature, Les Bomb.
Redefine is still going through the whole festival circuit, maybe for another year. And I'm currently working on a short film that I'm going to shoot in Jamaica in the summer, because that's where I'm from. So I want to do something there too.
So Mariachi Madness is going around in festivals. It will next be shown at the Chicago Latino Film Festival in April. And I'm going to be graduating in May, which is great. And my thesis film will be shown at the Columbia Film Festival in May, which is at the Walter Reed Theater.
As is also running in festivals right now, and I am currently writing a short about Christian extremist in America.
Oh, so a comedy, great.
And we actually won the best screenplay just the other night at a Deaf Rochester Film Festival. And we were selected for the Toronto Web Fest, which was recent. And we're encouraging you all to subscribe on YouTube to our series. And our ambition is to create a season 2 for it. So we're not giving up. Our hope is that someone will pick up our show and release it more generally than just YouTube.
Another round of applause for these guys. Thank you so much. Thanks. Congratulations, everyone.